we began alone in caves. We built fires to keep out the cold and to cast light against the darkness. We were afraid of a hostile world that we did not understand. We joined together and became families, and we tried to create something of value for ourselves and our children. We moved outward, away from darkness toward light. Families joined families. We built our first human settlement. Built villages, towns, and great cities, and living became easier and better.
We raised our children in hope and in joy. We reached into the great oceans and into the fertile earth for food and clothing. We needed to grow and prosper. We did not think beyond the present. We built homes and houses and great halls that sheltered our lives, our art, and our enterprise. And each year there were more of us. Between our villages and our towns and our cities, we built roads and bridges and highways over which we traveled. We grew. We learned more about our world as each generation moved outward in search of a better life, a better way of living. We dreamed for our children. And they, in turn, dreamed for theirs. The earth was our home and gave us freely of the beauty and riches it contained.
We grew, and the earth became smaller. On the farms, and suddenly in the villages, there was not enough. Not enough land to feed us all. Not enough food or clothing. Not enough hope or opportunity. And so we moved endlessly toward the great cities, where we thought there would be jobs and hope, and a chance to live a life of opportunity and fulfillment. We left the countryside, but it would no longer content us. And we came to the cities. For some of us in the beginning, it was good. The cities responded. And for some of us, living was good. For others, nothing changed. But we continued to come to the cities until the cities could no longer contain us. And we grew angry in our disappointment.
We had journeyed long and far to come here. And we had hoped for the opportunity to improve the quality of our lives. We were willing to work hard for ourselves and our children. But we found only the inhuman coldness of concrete and steel through which we could not breathe. The crowding grew greater, wiping out hope. The cities grew outward. And then, when there was no more space, they grew upward. And still we came to the cities, until they had nothing left to give us. But soon, too soon, there were too many of us. And under this burden, our cities finally cracked and broke.
We looked for work, but there was not enough work for all of us. Many of us worked at things we did not like or were unsuited for. And those of us who could not find work became idle. And in that river of idleness, were washed away our hopes for the future. We moved in ever-increasing numbers through the crowded arteries of our cities. And slowly, so slowly we did not notice, we had made too many of our human settlements unlivable.
And still we came to the cities, each of us a single pebble in a crushing avalanche. Our transportation systems slowed until they could no longer function. We lost a sense of community, a casualty of our struggle to survive. Living was no longer a thing of joy and hope. We became ill in our bodies and in our minds. Our health services could no longer cope with so many of us. To our children, we passed on a legacy of sickness and bitterness. The very foundations of our civilization, our social and political structures began to fragment and come apart. They became unresponsive to human need because they no longer had the resources to respond. We had built large bureaucracies to serve us. And now, as we crowded into a finite space, they became our masters, inhuman and silent, draining our resources and our energies to the rhythm of a mindless computer. We no longer participate in the way our human settlements are managed. There has been too much failure and too much disappointment. Some of us have ceased to believe that we can make a difference. And many of us, poisoned by that disappointment, have ceased to care. We wonder how this has happened and why. To many of us, there seem to be too many people.
In some places, there are too many people. In other places, there are too many people living in the wrong place, but the results are the same. We had meant for our children to be carefree, to grow outward. Instead, they grew in upon themselves. We had hoped to make of our human settlements places of peace and hope. Instead, we beat out our rage upon the pavements of our cities. We lose control, we take what we need. We attack our neighbors and we steal from them. Our children see us steal and kill. We no longer recognize ourselves. Our human settlements are in danger. The revered beliefs and traditions of the past, handed down to us by our forefathers and to them by theirs, are no longer intact. They do not work for us. How can we pass them on to our children, who mock us and cry because they have no food, no opportunities, no hope that tomorrow will be better? We look into the mirror of the future and see a day when there will be too many of us to be led and too few leaders who will want to lead. What will they say to us when we tell them of our needs and cannot reach them? They will not respond. We will hear only silence. In that vision, we are frightened. Where will we live 100 years from now, 200 years from now? What will our children's children